Hello?
Sharon.
We're in Ward 1. You can't miss us.
I'm standing in Ward 1.
Sharon, here I am. Come on. These people won't tell me what happened to them. Look at them. They say you have to be a relative before they can tell you anything. He's been like a brother to him for years. He's been like a father to me.
Calm down, child. You can speak to somebody.
Okay. Here, speak to them about turning that radio off too.
Sometimes music can help people when they aren't feeling well.
That's not music. That's just two black men talking.
That's Akon. He does lonely. It's on your phone.
No, it's not. It's a wee yellow bird sings on my phone.
It's Akon.
That doesn't matter. What sort of a friend would I be if I left him here to die while the radio was playing that? That shouldn't be the last thing a person hears.
The last thing he hears. Who's dying? What's happening? Am I dying? What have I said?
Oh, Hugh. Thank goodness, man. I thought you were a goner.
How are you feeling? Do you want me to get a doctor or a nurse?
How am I feeling? How do you think I'm feeling? I wake up in a hospital bed with wires and tubes everywhere. At least I hope that's the tube I'm sitting on. After having a nightmare in which this buck agent is sitting at my hospital bedside whispering in my ear, run away from the light.
Well, they wouldn't tell me anything. And look at all this. Even your Beryl doesn't know what's happening. I phoned her, by the way. She's heading down after she gets her dinner.
Oh, the bad news just keeps on coming.
Is there anything I can get for you before she gets here, Hugh?
You can get me the doctor who has the authority to take all these machines away and let me go home.
I can't see them letting you out of here anytime soon.
What happened to you?
It started at exactly 7:31 p.m. One of her soaps came on the box and I just said to myself, that's me. Exit stage left, big Hugh.
Tell him without the bells and whistles. We just need the facts before the doctor gets here or somebody throws us out.
It'll take a lot longer if you keep interrupting.
Go then.
I says to my Beryl, I'm away here, love, a wee drive. I might call into the club and have one or two beers. I just threw in that bit to see if she was listening. But she wasn't, or she would have said some. Believe you me, my Beryl wouldn't stand for any drinking and driving.
You don't get to the main facts very fast. I swear to God, I'd pull all those tubes out with my own bare hands, doctor or no doctor.
I went for a wee drive. Anyway, I bumped into wee Herbert from Innes Drive, and he said he had to go and see his mum. And she lives on the other side of town, so I says, jump in.
Is wee Herbert's mum still alive? God, she must be a queer age.
Leave it.
I takes him through town anyway. And I'm sitting on the motorway doing, oh God, about 50. And up comes this fly man behind me. Starts flashing his lights like he owns the road and I should move over for him. So Herbert says, you'd best let him pass you. I didn't say nothing to him. But before I could do anything, your man was already overtaking me in the inside. That's illegal, you know. Well, the next thing I see is him swerving right in front of us and flying on. Guess what?
We have to guess what happened now, have we?
He only had an Irish registration. What? Coming up here into my country and practically forcing me off the road in his big Irish Fenian Catholic car? I don't think so. Boot to the bird. Bang. Now, remember, Charlie, I drive a Jag, so I caught up with him in no time at all. Only this time it was me giving him the lights for him to move his Irish piece of shit out of the way of my best of British car. But he didn't. So I says to myself, funny man, are you? And did to him what he did to me. Up the inside and that's it.
And what's it? What happened?
That's all I can remember. Anyway, do you want to hear my dream?
No, that's not it. Haven't told us one part of any story that tells us how you ended up in here.
Well, I'm lying here and the Jag's a write-off, so it doesn't take a magician to work out what happened then.
You mean a mind reader? Magicians can't tell what happened.
Neither can mind readers. Sure, if they could read my mind, they won't find out what happened because I can't remember what happened.
They help you remember.
Never mind that. What about Herbert?
Herbert didn't make it.
You're joking. Does his family know?
To his mum's house. He got a taxi home instead. You should have seen your face there. What was it like?
maybe we should head on and let him get some rest.
I want to stay for a wee while, at least until Beryl gets here.
Well, stay here till I tell you about my dream.
Charlie, do you think you should be encouraging him to get excited?
I dreamed I died.
Maybe it's time to pack the driving in, mate.
Let me tell you something. If this dream was true, I would go out again and crash the car all over the place and make sure I did it properly.
Why? What was so special about this dream?
I went up to heaven.
This dream is losing credibility already.
Guess who was there?
Your daughter.
Yes. And so was her daughter.
Was her baby going to be a girl if it had been born?
Yes. Do you not know that? Guess who else was there? You and your whole team, all kitted out, mate, like the old days. You were even young.
I am young.
The first thing I hear as an angel led me through these big giant gates was a booming lambeg drum. And my girls took an arm each and we began to walk towards the music. It was so loud, it was unbelievable. And I thought to myself, that can only be one person. Charlie Moreland. The greatest all-round multi-talented musician I've ever heard. Booming away. Young lad out in front that never dropped a button in his life was twirling away and throwing it so high it disappeared into the clouds. And then, when it reappeared, bang, he caught it every time. And off you went, marching so proud, so magical. I felt the tears in my eyes. I even remember thinking, that proves it isn't a dream. Because you can't feel tears in your dreams, can you?
It was a dream.
Heaven was crowded with massive, massive, must have been millions of prods. All out to clap and cheer. And I said to the angel, what's this for? I was sort of hoping he would say that you had come out for me. You know, like my arrival had been announced and that you'd all turned out special-like, but it wasn't. It was even better than that. The angel smiled at me. Definitely a Protestant angel. Big, white, gleaming teeth. And guess what he said? He said it's the 12th of July every day in heaven. Boy, I can't explain the feeling. I mean, I've been thinking a lot about heaven ever since I had my first wee heart attack, but this was so much better than anything I ever thought of by myself. It was like God was telling me that my life wasn't wasted. And all the fights we had with everybody were worth it. But from now on, there'd be no more fights. And the angel said there would never be another protest, no matter if we marched all over heaven. And I said, why not? And he said, simple. There are no tigs in heaven.
Angel wouldn't call Catholic tigs, now would it?
He did, and he took me over and told me to have a look myself. Now remember, we're very high up, so when I first looked, I couldn't really see anything, because I got a bit dizzy and I felt a wee bit sick. But then with the music booming behind me, my two girls holding an arm each, my family and friends surrounding me, I suddenly felt invincible. So I leaned over further and looked down, and then I saw it. Hell. And it was full of Catholics. The IRA was there, burning in a big lake as far as the eye can see. And they were being tortured. And they were screaming and crying and yelling out for help.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.